identity as a sick man of Asia brought a sense of pride and destiny to our country. A feeling that finally we are on the cusp of change and people's lives are going to get better for good. But are we safely out of sick bay?
Can the promises of the tax reform package and ambitious infrastructure program bring the change our country craves? And what are the possibility of charter change?
Joining us in the studio today is former Socioeconomic Planning Secretary Cielito F. Habito. I still remember the middle initial.
Dr. Habito, thanks for joining us.
Thank you for being here.
So the GDP numbers came out last week, and we'd like to tear that down for the people who are watching the show. What do you think of the numbers?
Well, it shows that we are sustaining the growth rate that we have been having in the last couple of years. And in fact, it's quite significant the way that Secretary Pernia of NEDA put it, that if you look at the past post-election years, there was a deep dive in the growth rate in the years following the election year. In this case, we are sustaining that, and it's quite different from our recent experience. And so that seems to show us that there is some kind of sustainability in the momentum that we have achieved. So it's not just about election spending having propped up our growth in 2016, but we have sustained, in fact, a rate of growth that is close. Although, you know, we were slightly slower than last year because, mm-hmm. of course, there was always that election year element that kicks it up all the time. But it's quite remarkable that we are actually sustaining a more than 6%, in fact, close to 7% overall GDP growth, even after after the election year itself.
Well, I hear a but somewhere.
Yeah, I'm trying to explore that but as well. You know, notwithstanding the 0.2% slide from last year, some of the legs of the economy are actually quite surprising. I note that industry, for example, is growing at a faster pace than services. Can you take us through that phenomenon right now?
Well, in fact, it's quite heartening to see that industry, and this is primarily manufacturing, about 70 to 80%. Of which is manufacturing, is really what's propelling much of that growth right now. In fact, I like to point out how the quality of the growth of our economy is improving precisely because on the supply side, whereas we used to be so dependent on services pushing our growth, this time industry is taking a much bigger percentage in terms of contribution to the growth of the economy.
That's a change from the previous year, because manufacturing already showed and industry already showed some strength in the past year.
It's been happening since 2010, in fact. 2010 seems to have been the turning point because, I've done some calculations, in fact, that 6 years previous to 2010, manufacturing was only growing at an average of 3.3% a year. But since 2010 up to 2017, the average, and I recalculated it, actually was 7.8%. Mm-hmm. So we really note that that is faster than the growth of the entire economy.
Yeah.
So that means it's pulling up. Mm-hmm. Or pushing up the full economy.
And at 7.3%, eclipsing services, which is only 6.8%. May I also ask, I mean, the third leg, the one that's been undervalued for the last several years, is agriculture. That's mm-hmm. undergone a reversal of fortune, so to speak, from a contraction of 1.3% to around 2.4%. Is there something, though, that still needs to be prodded to make that sector more sustainable?
Yeah, still weak, no? Still weak.
It is relatively weak still. In fact, of course, the negative performance in the previous year was largely because of the El Nino and then the subsequent La Nina. Mm-hmm. And still, you know, now that the negative has reversed, we could still do much better, obviously. And it's really a matter of just getting our act together in agriculture. There are both macro policy constraints that are still there, but also program and, you know, sectoral and micro level constraints as well.
This was meaning your PhD. This was your dissertation of agriculture.
Well, in my master's thesis, I was looking at rice post-harvest mm-hmm. technologies and how that matters, in fact, as far as rural employment is concerned and so on. But agriculture is really something. By the way, I should mention my first undergraduate degree was in agriculture. Yeah. I was a BS agriculture graduate of UP Los Baños. So it's close to my heart. And I've been watching it closely through the years with a lot of frustration, frankly, yeah. because so much could happen if we only didn't do some of the things we keep doing.
But I keep in mind your pitik. The jobs. So if you're saying that it's industry and manufacturing, we're seeing a better quality of growth in terms of people are sort of feeling it already because the jobs are better.
I would think so because it actually shows up in the employment numbers as well.
5%.
The fact that first of all, unemployment rate is 5%, and it's we're at a very low rate compared to our historical averages. But more than that, the quality of jobs a very clear evidence that the quality of jobs is improving. Underemployment is now below 16%, and it's also a fact that the proportion of wage and salary employees out of the total workers in the economy, total employed workers in the economy, has grown substantially through the years. Before it was less than half who are wage and salary workers. Now it's more than 60%, meaning that I consider these to be the better quality jobs, unlike the informal sector jobs, which are either the category of self-employed or unpaid family workers. Those respective proportions have gone down in favor of more wage and salary jobs, precisely because of manufacturing having had a bigger contribution now to the growth.
So by its nature, having a better value chain, for example, in manufacturing, especially when you go up, for example, the supply chain also. Let me ask, though, Dr. Habito, when you talk about this administration's focus on build and infrastructure, that tends to cut across those three sectors.
Oh, yes.
I mean, agriculture, farm-to-market, roads and irrigation, and manufacturing. How must the government act in terms of calibrating those investments to make sure that these sectors get the fillip from the full brunt of infrastructure spending?
Well, first of all, we need to look at the geographical allocation of our public investment spending, particularly infrastructure. One of the things that I'm alarmed about upon closer examination of the numbers is that we seem to be getting more Manila and Luzon-centric in our economy's growth. You know, from just about 30% in 1996, the share of Metro Manila in our total GDP has gone up to now 37%. So it actually went to about 33% in 2006. And then another 10 years later, it's 37%. It's growing.
Why is that?
Well, that only tells us that in the past years, at least, but the major growth of our economy was coming from Metro Manila. And that's more of the services sector, frankly. Mm-hmm. And that's why services had traditionally been the driver of our economy's growth. But now that we're seeing manufacturing, then you throw in Calabarzon and Central Luzon as well, which are highly industrialized regions. But then again, if you look at Calabarzon, Central Luzon, and Metro Manila, the share has been going up also. So that now it's accounting for 63%.
Wow.
So what this is worrying me about is the fact that that means that the rest of the country, especially more remote areas in Mindanao especially, are still not able to participate enough in our economy's activities and growth.
It lends certainly to the argument for secondary cities and decentralizing that growth outside the infrastructure. I mean, the last statistic we saw from the PPP Center was that the last administration, 80% of the PPP projects were based in Metro Manila. How do you now move the needle sustainably to make sure there's absorptive capacity in those rural areas so that money comes in and gets used productively?
And the political lens, yes, I think, was that this wasn't what was promised during the start of this administration.
Well, of course, there are some prominent projects like the Mindanao Railway, which was never there in the blueprints in the past. And obviously, these are deliberate efforts to actually show that there will be more public investment in infrastructure in the more traditionally neglected areas, especially in Mindanao. And that should help boost industrialization, industrial activities in general, in the island of Mindanao. And hopefully, again, you know, and for the longest time, we've been waiting for that peace agreement and the basic Bangsamoro law. I mean, if that can finally get settled, then that would unleash even more interest in the region as far as investments, both from within the Philippines and from outside of the country are concerned.
Can charter change and federalism change this?
Well, that's a very controversial issue, as we all know. Many people seem to think that federalism is the answer to achieve that autonomy that our Muslim brothers have been crying for many, many years. However, we all can see that there are problems. As they say, there's devils in the details in this, how you actually implement federalism.
But there are no details.
Well, they claim, I've seen some, and there are some groups, there is at least one group that has been trying to work out more details on this, but again, it's not widely known.
Yes.
The question remains that, you know, do you really need to go to federalism or just improve on the devolution and decentralization?
With the current system right now.
Which is already in the law.
With the LG, local government code
local
and all that.
Government
code. But let me ask you, I mean, Dr. Abby, you've seen other countries' best practices in terms of the way they've also shared governance and done decentralization, either federalism or, you know, with the current stat or the status quo. Mm-hmm. What do you should work? Or what can you see is a best practice that allows governments to decentralize, whether or not they change the system? What is the key common denominator there?
Well, whatever the configuration that we take, I still believe that more devolution and more decentralization is good for the country. Mm-hmm. In fact, you know, I served in the government under President Ramos, where the five D's of his primary strategy included two, which are devolution and decentralization, meaning that, you know, you really have to have a more bottom-up approach to our country's development, economic and otherwise. And this remains very true, especially now that we're seeing, as I said, an increasing Manila-centric and Luzon-centric growth
Imperial
in the economy.
Manila,
so we have to really move out of that. And the only way is to really get more out of our more remote regions, in fact.
And this is an important conversation, especially in the lands of inclusive growth, because you don't just want higher 6.5, 7%, 8%. And that's all in Metro Manila. How about the rest of the Philippines? And poverty is still very high in many areas. And that inequality has not been looked at very much in the last years until it resulted in volatility elsewhere in the world and in the Philippines as well. So in terms of financial, economic inclusion, inclusive growth, what do we still need to do to make that happen? The prices are low now, and that allows people who are earning more to take advantage of the benefits of having higher income. But what else aside from that?
Well, the government is on the right track in really emphasizing and focusing on micro, small, and medium enterprises. The key is to get more small firms and small farms to participate in and benefit from our economy's growth. Mm-hmm. And so the Department of Trade and Industry and Secretary Lopez,
yeah,
of course,
been all over from, the
his,
place.
From his Go Negosyo background, has been really pushing. And, you know, of course, even his predecessors mm-hmm. had already been pushing for MSME development.
What are
That's
the barriers
key.
There?
The traditional barriers have been financing.
Access to finance.
And, yeah. You know, that's why number
one. We have
one,
a lot of money in the Philippines. Cash is just sloshing around the system.
A lot of it is mindset, frankly, yeah. And that's the reason I think why mindset is number one in the seven M's of Secretary Lopez.
Mindset of who? Like, you sit in some of the boards of the banks. Is it the mindset of the financial institution? Is it the mindset of the government? What is it?
It's mindsets of at least three parties. The banks, again, obvious, because there's always that tendency to prefer a small number of large clients to a large number of small ones.
So payment
easy
risk
money.
Is actually averted, right?
It's
so,
easy money.
Yeah, it's easier to move the money that way. So that's a natural tendency. But yeah, we can. There should be a way to overcome that. Secondly, it's mindsets in government itself. Again, one particular mindset I have in mind is how our development banks seem to be expected by our financial authorities to produce profits and revenues for the government. Right, and you know, their primary mission of serving small enterprises and small farmers are put on the background because they have to make a profit. And yet, I found out that most of the countries that have been very successful in bringing money to the small people, the small enterprises, perennially recapitalize their financial institutions that cater precisely to that sector.
Curious about that. Can't it be profitable to lend to small farmers? And
that's the thing, you know. There's an inherent issue of difficulty in getting profitability or profits from these kinds of institutions. In fact, we have to accept the reality that they have to be subsidized.
Yeah.
And, you know, as an economist, I argue that it's a public good to be able to actually have a flourishing small farm and small firm sector, and therefore deserves taxpayers.
In terms of calibrating that, though, you talk about mindset, development banks and rural banks. I mean, are we looking now at a different set of criteria and socialized returns, for example, that you would have to apply vis-a-vis the corporate borrowers? Does there need to be now more deliberate push towards looking at them as a very specific lens?
Let me add, because I was just very excited. I was going to comment about that. We've talked about this so much in the show, where banks are expecting small businesses or even farmers to give them 3 years track record and financial statements when they don't have it clearly.
One size fits all doesn't really work, right?
They won't be able to borrow money if that's the expectation.
Those are the things where we need to have some kind of a change in mindset. And, you know, one can argue, how can a starting business ever in fact get access to credit if there's that initial hurdle to that gets in the way.
I believe it was your article recently that showed that we lag behind in terms of the lending growth to SMEs. I think Thailand is twice the rate that we have. I think we're at 6%, Thailand's at 12%. What kind of best practices are we learning or are we seeing from the ASEAN neighbors that we can replicate here while working with the local culture and landscape?
Well, one particular concern is really having a different kind of regulatory treatment for development banks as against the regular banks. When it comes, and the Banco Central can very much take care of that. And I think they're into that mode now, especially with their much stronger financial inclusion program. The thing is, in other countries, a different set of regulatory rules apply to regular commercial banks as against development banks. And that includes, again, allowing for some, shall we say, leeway in terms of profitability. Because, again, you don't expect these banks to be profitable if they're true to their mission.
In short, your measurement of performance for the development banks cannot be the same as the big banks. And maybe your measurement of risk as well.
Yes.
And perhaps cost of compliance as well, because, I mean, they don't have to go through so many hoops in terms of trying to be able to access these loans.
I'd like to bring down the conversation on GDP to the kitchen table, so to speak. So people who are now watching and listening and saying, okay, so this is what growth looks like. We're sustaining it naman. And these are the industries that are doing well. How do we as individuals take advantage of all of these trends? You said there's risk still because we're lagging behind compared with our other neighbors. But what else can we do so that we can benefit from this kind of growth?
Well, the one thing I would say is that, you know, think of how you yourself can contribute to the economy through entrepreneurship, through actually setting up a small business and hopefully growing it to go beyond small business. But really, we need a much more entrepreneurial culture in our country. And I see this as somewhat a clear difference with some of our neighboring countries in terms of the contribution of the micro, small, and medium enterprises to GDP or to total employment. We are actually well behind our neighbors as far as job contribution and GDP contribution of small firms.
Even in the use of technology,
even if they're 99% of our registered enterprises, they're still under a third of GDP.
That's exactly the problem, that we have a very high percentage of our company, our firms, under that small category, micro to small to medium,
SMEs.
And yet their contribution is much weaker. So there's something wrong about the nature itself, I suppose, of our MSMEs.
Can technology make that better?
It will, definitely.
And that's the reason why
this is, you know, access to technology is one of the key constraints also of MSMEs, perhaps next to finance. And obviously, a small firm does not have the in-house capability to have its own research and development. You'll have to harness our public research institutions in the academe, in the Department of Science and Technology mechanisms to be able to come up with the kind of technologies and technical support that small firms need.
Thank you so much. Thank you so much. It's been very good to see you
again. Full plate, but thank you for
highlighting
me as the agenda.
Thank you.